हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे द क्लास इज़ ऑन ओवेरियन कैंसर। दिस इज़ इन कंटिन्यूटी विद आवर प्रीवियस क्लास दैट वाज ऑन नॉन न्योप्लास्टिक ओवेरियन एनलार्जमेंट्स एंड ओवेरियन ट्यूमर्स। सो टुडे वी आर डीलिंग विद मैलिग्नेंट ओवेरियन मैसेज और ओवेरियन कैंसर। एज वी ऑल नो, ovarian cancer is the second most common of all genital cancers and accounts for 10-15% of all gynecological cancers in developing countries, second to cancer cervix, including our country, that is India. It accounts for 3-4% of cancer in women as a whole and is the fourth most frequent cause of cancer related deaths in female in western countries. Ovarian cancer, as I told you, is the second most common gynecological malignancy, endometrial cancer being the most common in developed world, and carcinoma cervix is the most common in developing countries like ours, and is the most common cause of death among women who develop a gynecological malignancy. In general, ovarian cancer is a disease of the postmenopausal woman with the highest incidence among patients aged more than 65 years, but usually within 75 years. The risk increases with age up to 70 years. Over the past two decades, there has been an increase in the incidence as well as survival rate amongst women with ovarian cancer. The risk of a woman developing cancer of the ovary in her lifetime is around 1:70 to 1:100. So, this is in brief the introduction. Now, types of ovarian cancer. As we all know, the ovary is made up of three types of cell: epithelial cells, then germ cells, and stromal cells. So accordingly, cancers also arising from these three types of cells. Epithelial cancer accounting for 90% of malignant ovarian cancers. Then germ cell cancer starts from germ cells, that is cells lining that are destined to form eggs within the ovaries. And stromal cell cancer begins in the cells that hold the ovaries together and produce female hormones. This is the picture of a normal ovary where we see corpus luteum. Once ovulation has occurred, one mature egg is shown, growing follicle is also shown, and we see the germ cell layer also. Now coming to pathology, ovarian cancer can be divided into three major categories based on the cell type of origin, as I told you. That is epithelial cells, germ cells, and stromal cells. The ovary may also be the site of metastatic disease by primary cancer from another organ site like GIT, stomach, large bowel, and even small bowel. Unlike carcinomas of the cervix and endometrium, precursor lesions of ovarian carcinoma have not been defined yet. Now, pathology, major histopathological categories, as I told you in last class also, in summary, epithelial cells having the variety of serous cells, then mucinous adenocarcinoma, then endometrioid variety, clear cell carcinoma, transitional cell or Brenner tumors, and undifferentiated types. Germ cell tumors like dysgerminomas, then endodermal sinus tumor, teratomas can be immature, mature, or specialized. In embryonal carcinomas, choriocarcinomas, gonadoblastomas, mixed germ cells, and polyembryoma. Then sex cord and stromal variety, these have the types of granulosa cell tumor, fibromas, thecomas group, then Sertoli-Leydig cell tumors, and gynandroblastomas. So these are the major histopathological categories of ovarian cancer. Then neoplasms are metastatic to the ovary, primary coming from breast, colon, stomach, can be from endometrium, and it can be even lymphomas. Now coming to Krukenberg tumor, this is the name is very fascinating, no? So what is Krukenberg tumor? Krukenberg tumor, this type of tumor should be diagnosed only if it conforms to the following pattern. Krukenberg tumors are almost bilateral, and these are ovarian metastases from signet ring cell adenocarcinomas. We don't use this term for metastasis of different histologic origin. Commonly, primary is gastric, but can also be breast colon, as I told you earlier. Then lymphatic pathway of spread is there and can occur without other metastasis. The features are, these are commonly bilateral, usually large of more than 10 centimeters, predominantly solid, lobulated and enhancing lesions. These tumors are almost bilateral, as I told you. They have smooth surface which may be slightly bossed. They are freely movable in the pelvis. There is no tendency to form adhesions with neighboring viscera and there is no infiltration through the capsule. The tumor, the most characteristic feature is that the tumor retains the shape of the normal ovary and has a peculiar solid waxy consistency, although cystic spaces due to degeneration of the growths are common. Krukenberg tumor has a solid waxy appearance with an intact capsule and free of all adhesions, and the cut surface is uniform and it preserves the shape of the ovary. In summary, these are usually found in mucinous tumors of the ovary. Then coming to pathogenesis, ovarian carcinogenesis can be divided into two broad phases. First is malignant transformation, as we have read in our last lecture, that is benign tumors are there, then there are borderline malignant or tumors of low malignant potential. Then coming to malignant ovarian tumors, and the second one is peritoneal dissemination, but this theory is not very much of validity. Now, epithelial cell tumors, which are the most common, approximately 3/4 of the ovarian cancers, these are of two types, type 1 and type 2. And type 1 is low grade, arises from precursor lesions in a stepwise fashion, mostly serous cystadenoma and borderline tumors, typically present in stage 1. Slow-growing indolent tumors often remains low-grade. Examples are low-grade micropapillaries, then mucinous cystadenomas, then clear cells and endometrioid cells carcinoma. And type 2 is high-grade tumor, arise de novo, typically present in advanced stage, rapidly growing aggressive tumors, and examples are high-grade serous tumors. Then types of ovarian tumors or ovarian cancer, as we have discussed earlier also, ovaries contains mainly three types of cells, epithelial, germ cell and stromal cells, and each of these cells can develop into different types of tumors. So the cancer can be epithelial cancers, germ cell cancers and stromal cancers. Then coming to the risk factors, the main risk factors are of family history, then ethnicity also is carrying a risk, or it is considered as a risk factor, then reproduction and others. Now family history. The family history is the strongest risk factor. A woman with a single first degree relative with an ovarian carcinoma has a relative risk of approximately 3.6 for developing ovarian carcinoma compared to general population, and her lifetime risk is approximately 5%. 5 to 10% of ovarian carcinomas are linked to identifiable inherited mutations in the certain genes. Families in which three or more first degree relatives have ovarian or ovarian plus breast carcinoma are likely to have a cancer susceptibility genetic mutation that is transmitted in an autosomal dominant inheritance pattern. Three familial ovarian cancer syndromes are identified. These are site-specific ovarian cancer syndromes, where only ovarian carcinoma is seen and account for 10 to 15% of hereditary ovarian carcinomas. Then hereditary ovarian and breast carcinoma syndrome, it is associated with 65 to 75% of hereditary ovarian cancer. That is the most prevalent type. And the third one is hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer syndrome, that is HNPCC. Affected individuals may have colon, endometrial, breast, ovarian, or can be other cancers. Then ethnicity. As we all know, it is higher in white population or Western women, and especially higher in North America and Northern Europe. And difference related to genetics, then diet, then environmental exposure, or a combination. BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes are more common among white women of Ashkenazi descent. 5 to 10% malignant ovarian cancers are genetic, and BRCA1 and BRCA2 gene mutations are implicated. As we know, BRCA1 gene mutation on chromosome 17 and BRCA2 gene mutation on chromosome 13 are noted. And BRCA1 is more carcinogenic than BRCA2, and it occurs earlier in life. Incidence of a carcinoma is higher in countries with higher per capita consumption of animal fat. Then comes reproduction factors. So nulliparous lady, first childbirth after age 35 years, involuntary infertility or infertility treatment with IVF, late menopause and early menarche, and patients with prolonged period or uninterrupted ovulation. Like means ovulation trauma to the epithelial lining is thought to be carcinogenic, where there are more ovulation or more number of trauma to the ovary due to ovulation, the chances of developing carcinoma is more. Others are exogenous hormones like HRT. Then dietary factors may comes diet high in saturated animal fats seem to confer the increased risk by unknown mechanism. Then coming to protective factors, multiparity, then breastfeeding, then comes oral contraceptive pills, anovulation, leading to anovulation. These are helpful, and these act as protective factors. Tubal ligation, hysterectomy, bilateral oophorectomy, prophylactic bilateral oophorectomy. Then epidemiologic and laboratory evidence suggest a potential role for retinoids, vitamin D and NSAIDs also as preventive agents for ovarian cancer. Then symptoms of ovarian cancer. As we all know, ovarian cancer is very indolent types. Like early symptoms of ovarian cancer are pain in the pelvis, pain on the lower side of the body, back pain, indigestion or heartburn, more frequent and urgent urination, and pain during sexual intercourse. The clinical features are non-specific in early stages, resulting in late diagnosis in 70% of cases. A woman with a malignant ovarian tumor is either an adolescent or a menopausal or postmenopausal age of low parity. And so we have to cautiously take the family history, because family history of breast or ovarian tumor, it is very relevant. Initially, the woman is asymptomatic, so symptoms are very indolent type. As ovarian cancer progresses, these symptoms are also seen, like nausea, weight loss, breathlessness, fatigue or tiredness, loss of appetite. Malignant ovarian tumors are often bilateral, solid and present with ascites, and the only benign tumors that cause ascites are ovarian fibromas, as we have seen in or we have learned in our last lecture. Then coming to FIGO staging of ovarian carcinoma. Stage 1, where the tumor is confined to the single ovary or both ovaries. Again divided as 1A, 1B and 1C. 1A, only one ovary is affected by the tumor. The ovary capsule is intact. No tumor is detected on the surface of the ovary, and malignant cells are not detected in ascites or peritoneal washings. 1B, both ovaries are affected by the tumor, the ovary capsule is intact and no tumor is detected on the surface of the ovaries, and malignant cells are not seen in the ascites or peritoneal washings. Then 1C, where the tumor is limited to one or both ovaries with any one of the following. Either the capsule is ruptured or the tumor is detected on the ovarian surface, and positive malignant cells are detected in the ascites or peritoneal washings. Then coming to stage 2. Stage 2, where the tumor involves one or both ovaries and has extended into the pelvis. Again divided as 2A, 2B and 2C. 2A, where the tumor has extended and or implanted into the uterus and or fallopian tubes. Malignant cells are not detected in ascites or peritoneal washings. 2B, the tumor has extended to another organ in the pelvis. Malignant cells are not detected in ascites or peritoneal washings. But 2C, where the tumors are either 2A or B and malignant cells are detected in the ascites or peritoneal washings. Then coming to stage 3, the tumor involves one or both ovaries with microscopically confirmed peritoneal metastasis outside the pelvis and or regional lymph node metastasis. It includes, mind it, it includes liver capsule metastasis, not liver parenchyma, but liver capsule metastasis. So 3A, 3B and 3C again. 3A is microscopic peritoneal metastasis beyond the pelvis. 3B is microscopic peritoneal metastasis beyond the pelvis, 2 cm or less in grotesque dimension. Then 3C, where microscopic peritoneal metastasis beyond the pelvis, more than 2 cm in grotesque dimension and or regional lymph node metastasis. Then coming to stage 4. Stage 4 is distant metastasis beyond the peritoneal cavity, and here liver parenchymal metastasis is there. Now coming to prognosis, stage wise prognosis of ovarian cancer, it is measured in terms of 5-year survival. So stage 1, confined to ovary, 90-95% of 5-year survival. Stage 2 is confined to pelvis and 70-80% of survival. Stage 3, where intra-abdominal spread, 20-50% of 5-year survival. And stage 4 is spread outside abdomen and survival is only grim, that is 1-5%. Prognosis according to the types of tumors. So germ cell tumors are associated with a better 5-year survival rates than epithelial ovarian neoplasms. Patients with disc germinoma have a 5-year survival rate of 95%, immature teratoma 70-80%, and endodermal sinus tumor is associated with a 5-year survival rate of only 60-70%. Now coming to diagnosis and clinical evaluation. Ovarian cancers typically develop as an insidious disease with few warning signs and symptoms. Most neoplastic ovarian tumors produce very few symptoms until the disease is widely disseminated throughout the abdominal cavity, and so the diagnosis is very late. A history of non-specific GI complaints including nausea, dyspepsia and altered bowel habits is particularly common. Abdominal distension as a result of ascites are generally signs of advanced disease. A change in bowel habits such as constipation and decreased stool caliber is occasionally noted. Large tumors may cause a sensation of pelvic pressure or pelvic weight. Rarely, an ovarian tumor may become incarcerated in the cul-de-sac and cause severe pain, urinary retention, rectal discomfort, and bowel obstruction. Menstrual abnormalities may be noted in as many as 15% of reproductive age patients with an ovarian neoplasm, and vaginal bleeding may occur in patients with ovarian cancer in the presence of a synchronous endometrial carcinoma or as a consequence of a metastatic disease to the lower genital tract. And ovarian stromal hyperplasia or hyperthicosis also may be associated with excess androgen production, which alters the normal menstrual cycle. So hormone producing cancers are usually associated with alteration in the bleeding pattern. On physical examination, first general examination, then coming to abdominal examination. Abdominal distension is one of the more common finding. The presence of lank fullness and shifting dullness implies the presence of ascites or a large pelvic abdominal mass. Recent eversion of the umbilicus can be seen. Lymph node examination may we see supraclavicular and inguinal areas. Sister Mary Joseph's nodule, very interesting term. It refers to a metastatic implant in the umbilicus. Then in pelvic examination, careful and thorough pelvic examination provides many helpful clues regarding the etiology of a pelvic mass. Benign mass are usually mobile, smooth, cystic and unilateral, and malignant masses are fixed, irregular, solid or firm and bilateral. We have to do the differential diagnosis. So what can be the differential diagnosis of a pelvic mass? These are endometriomas, fibroid, functional cyst, ectopic pregnancy and dermoid tumor, especially in young women. Then coming to investigation parts. First,
about tumor markers. Tumor marker, what are these? An antigenic determinant on a high molecular weight glycoprotein recognized by murine monoclonal antibody is CA125. Upper limit of normal is 35 units per ml, and in postmenopausal women, lower cutoff is 20 units per ml. 85% of patients with epithelial ovarian cancers have more than 35 units per ml of CA125. It can also be elevated in mucinous, clear cell and borderline tumors, but less frequently elevated as compared to serous tumors. And in other malignancies like pancreas, breast, colon and lung cancer, also it is increased. And some benign conditions like pregnancy, endometriosis and menstruation also, the level is increased. Then, tumor, one of the limitations of CA125 is that 15-20% of ovarian cancers do not express the antigen. There are some other markers apart from CA125 found in other types of ovarian cancers. One is LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, increased level is found in this germinoma. Then HCG, human chorionic gonadotrophins in choriocarcinomas. Then alpha fetoprotein or AFP in endodermal sinus tumors, and some other routine lab tests are also done. These are CBC, LFT, RFT, chest X-ray, like that. Now coming to investigations or mode of diagnosis by ultrasound. So ultrasound is the initial imaging modality of choice for benign versus malignant. It detects more stage 1 ovarian cancer than CA125 and physical examinations. Then findings of benign ovarian cancer in ultrasound. Benign tumors are smooth, thin walls, few thin septations are there, absence of solid components or mural nodularity. But in malignancy, the findings are of mural nodules, mural thickening or irregularity, solid components, thick septations of up to 3 mm or more, and then associated findings such as ascites, peritoneal implants and or hydronephrosis. If these are found, this suggests malignancy. Then computed tomography or CT scan. It is not the study of choice to evaluate a suspected ovarian lesion. The sensitivity, specificity and accuracy of CT for characterizing benign versus malignant are respectively 89%, 96% to 99% and 92% to 94%. On CT, ovarian cancer demonstrates varied morphologic patterns including multilocular cyst with thick internal septations and solid mural or septal components, a partially cystic and solid mass and lobulated varieties. Then coming to MRI, it is complementary to ultrasound in the evaluation of a suspected ovarian lesion. As with CT, disease metastatic to the ovary is often indistinguishable from primary ovarian cancer on MRI scan. Both the colon and the stomach should be examined as potential primary tumor sites if an ovarian mass is detected. Several studies have compared MRI to CT and ultrasound for adnexal masses with mixed results. Both TVS and MRI have high sensitivity in the identification of solid components within an adnexal mass. However, MRI shows higher specificity, like 98% versus 46%. MRI was shown to be the most efficient second test when an indeterminate ovarian mass was detected at ultrasound. High cost of MRI precludes its use as a screening modality. Then coming to PET scan, little clinical role in the primary detection of a pelvic mass and appears to be promising for its potential to detect tumor prior to significant morphologic changes. Ultrasound, CT, MRI and PET all have a role to play in the accurate staging of ovarian cancer. Particularly, a PET scan also play a role in the monitoring of therapy and detection of recurrent diseases. Especially, this role is very important for PET. Then about metastasis of ovarian cancer, typical spread is to the omentum, peritoneal surfaces such as under surface of diaphragm, paracolic gutters and bowel serosa. Lymphatics, via lymphatics, it follows blood supply through infundibulo pelvic ligament to nodes in paraaortic region, then drainage through broad ligament and parametrium, which involves external iliac, obturator and hypogastric regions. A long round ligament involves inguinal nodes, and extra-abdominal metastasis is found to the pleura, lung, spleen, liver, bones and CNS. Then coming to screening, 5-year survival rates for stage 1 and 2 ovarian cancers are 80-90% and 70% respectively. Then for stage 3 and 4 from 5-30%, only 25% are diagnosed in stage 1. This is the most problematic thing as the diagnosis is delayed. NIH recommended that screening be offered to women with more than 2 first degree relatives with ovarian carcinoma. In practice, many women with a single first degree relatives are enrolled in screening programs. Unfortunately, there are no good screening methods for ovarian cancer at present. Most use a combination of physical examination, CA125 and TVS. No role of routine screening in general population, but some follow women with high risk factors like those having family history, BRCA mutation, by using CA125 and TVS. Then one very important term is RMI. What is this? Risk of malignancy index. Most valuable clinical tool by combining serum CA125 values with ultrasound findings and menopausal status to calculate a risk of malignancy index. RMI is equal to U into M into CA125, where U is ultrasound, a result in scored 1 point for each of the following characteristic like multilocular cyst, 1 solid areas, 1 metastasis, 1 ascites, 1 and bilateral lesions, 1. Then menopausal status is scored as 1, premenopausal and menopausal. And serum CA125 in international unit per ml and can vary between 0 and hundreds or even thousands of units. Then coming to management finally. So management can be complete surgical staging by laparotomy, then optimal cytoreductive surgery, then chemotherapy and various clinical trials and radiotherapy. So the treatment of ovarian cancer is based on the stage of the disease, which is a reflection of the extent and spread of the cancer to other parts of the body. There are basically 3 forms of treatment of ovarian cancer. The primary one is surgery, at which time the cancer is removed from the ovary and from as many other sites as possible. Then chemotherapy is the second important modality, and radiation treatment, which is used in only certain instances. It utilizes high energy x-rays to kill cancer cells. Laparotomy and maximum reduction in the is the primary and gold standard treatment, as I told you earlier, for all ovarian malignant tumors. And then surgical staging is followed by definitive surgery or debulking, followed by chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Stage 1 and 2, the operable cases should undergo total hysterectomy and bilateral salpingopharyngectomy with omentectomy. With lymphadenectomy, we can go for paraaortic lymph nodes, and advanced and inoperable cases like stage 3 and 4 will benefit from debulking surgery and removal of the tumor. Postoperative chemo and radiotherapy improve the survival and quality of life. One important point topic is interval surgery. Some advanced and bulky tumors are initially treated by chemotherapy for 3 cycles. This is followed by debulking surgery and postoperative chemotherapy as dictated by tissue marker. So, surgery is the mainstay of both the diagnosis and treatment. Vertical incision is required for adequate exposure of upper abdomen. Pelvis and upper abdomen are explored carefully to identify metastatic diseases, usually possible in the majority of 1 and 2, but impossible in advanced cases. Which type of surgery? As I told you earlier, complete hysterectomy and bilateral tubes and ovarian removal, then lymph node evaluation, omentectomy, can be intestinal resection, peritoneal stripping and tumor debulking, and conservative management for those desiring to preserve fertility with early stage diseases. as in adolescent girls. Then coming to chemotherapy. So a woman with stage 1A and 1B and well or moderately differentiated tumors will not require further treatment. But all other patients with invasive ovarian carcinoma require chemotherapy, that is stage 2 to 4, possibly 1C also. Drugs used are cisplatin, carboplatin and paclitaxel, as we all know. Then coming to radiation therapy. Currently, radiation therapy plays a limited role in the treatment of patients with epithelial ovarian cancer, mainly because of radiation damage to the small bowel, liver and kidneys. But these are successfully used in the treatment of patients with dysgerminoma, which are very much radiosensitive. Alternative therapies are like cytokines and monoclonal antibodies. Cytokines are like interleukin 2 and interferon, either alone or in combination with chemotherapy, have shown some promising effects. Then monoclonal antibodies directed against ovarian cancer associated antigen includes CA125 and human milk fat globulin. These are under trial. Recently, antibodies against VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, have shown efficacy in patients with ovarian cancer. Anti-VEGF antibodies are currently being tested in combination with carboplatin and paclitaxel in first-line chemotherapy. Gene therapy trials have used different anti-tumor approaches, including the delivery of tumor suppressor gene P53 via recombinant adenovirus into the peritoneal cavities. These early trials have not shown very significant clinical response, mainly as a result of the insufficiency of intraperitoneal and intratumoral gene transfer. So these are the various types of management what we do in cases of ovarian cancer. So this is all about ovarian cancer. Thank you.